socks.
So did Ben.
So did Ben. Good place to be. Everybody sounds like you're excited to be here. It's just a good place to be. You happy you're saved today?
Yeah.
I'll tell you, that's good. Dave has an old picture of me when I first started riding motorcycles with one of my girlfriends. And I want you, before you leave tonight after service, have Dave show you that picture.
I see.
Yeah. That's why I didn't say it was my wife. A good place to be. We've been visiting today the nursing homes and hospitals. Went over and seen Richard's wife. What a sweetheart. How in the world did you ever got her, Richard? I don't know. had a good time over there. We're looking forward to Bible study. She's only one of those that are in the nursing homes. Those that are sick. Brenda's not doing much better. So we remember her in prayer. She took a little turn for the worse. Amen? So good to have everybody here. I'm going to say a prayer and let Brother Ronnie take off. Mr. Meadows, you've been absent, so we're going to wear you out tonight for prayer. So how about you pray for us?
Put it in your pocket, it's good.
I just put it in my pocket down there. Okay. 777. Now I want to show you something here. Numbers in the Bible mean something. They're not just there for numbers. They literally mean something. God, biblical numerology, it is something that we can study. It actually means something. For instance, one means unity. That they may be one as we are one. Jesus said that they may be one in us. Two is witness, the number of witness. In the mouth of two, three witnesses, every word we establish. Three is the number of fullness. The fullness in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Colossians 2 says, speaking of Christ. Now, Trinity is three, right? Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. But in the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, there is a fullness of God. Okay, you follow me? Three is fullness. Four is the number of foundation. Four corners, you know, four square of the city. Five is the number of grace. It's always been the number of grace. Six is the number of man. Remember, on the sixth day God made man. That was his crowning creation. Sixth day. And 666 is the number of a man, Revelation 13 said. Now, we have a three and we have three sixes, in other words. It is the fullness of man. It is all that man can do in himself, is what that means. Now, mark the beast, we don't know what that is. But we do know the number of his name. And it's 666, which is the number of a man. Okay? Which means that three sixes mean that he is the embodiment of the fullness of all a man can be. Okay? You see what I'm saying? He is that. And of course, sometime maybe we'll get into the latent power of the soul and how he is able to master that. Adam had it, he lost it. The Antichrist will master it again in the 666. Seven is the number of completion or perfection. You know, seven seals, seven trumpets, seven vials. Seven parables in Matthew 13 is the number of God's completion. Now, having said that, let me lay this on you. We've got three sevens here, right? Three is the number of fullness. Seven is the number of completion. So this Hebrew calendar, 5777, marks the fullness of the completion of something. What? Grace. This year marks the absolute fullness of the completion of the time of the grace of God. Hey, that excites me, brother. Now, Jesus said nobody knows the day or hour. I'm not talking about the day or hour. I'm talking about a year. Now, I can't say that he'll come this year. And I know there'll be trolls on the internet that'll say I'm set the day. I'm not. I don't know if he'll come this year. But boy, this will be a good year. According to these numbers, 5777, the fullness of the completion of the grace of God. Wasn't that what Paul was talking about in Romans 11:25 when he said, I would not have the ignorant brethren concerning this mystery, how the blindness in part, temporary blindness, has happened to Israel until the fullness not known, as it is now manifested to the saints, that in this dispensation, or this time, this dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ. So we are living in the fullness of the completion of the wonderful grace of God. Man, I mean, now, as I said, I don't know if he's coming this year. The year forward. 57, 76. Could be. When was the last Jubilee year? This year, it could very well be. See, that's when God sets all men free. They go back to their inheritance.
Was
67 when they captured Jerusalem. Figured out Muhammad come along the 6th century, and you can still go find his burial ground in Bama. sword to which shall the sign be cut off, verse 26, but not for himself, crucified for us. Now notice, the people of the prince that shall come. Now this is not Christ. This is the prince that shall come. Who is the prince that shall come? Antichrist, isn't it? Now, if the prince that shall come is the Antichrist, then the people of the prince that shall come tells us who and from what background the Antichrist comes. For look, this is what they did. The people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, the temple. And the end thereof shall be with the flood. Of course, the flood of armies. And under the end, there are going to be wars and desolations. Now, in 70 AD, General Vespasius Titus marched into Jerusalem to put down a revolt by the Jews with his legions, and he destroyed the city and the sanctuary. He was a Roman, wasn't he? And the Bible said Christ prophesied in Luke 21, you know, the disciples asked, when will these things be? What will be the sign of thy coming? The end of the world. Those are three questions they needed to ask. Answered. And Christ said to them that when you see Jerusalem compassed about with armies, then know that the desolation there is nigh at hand. What he was saying was, there's coming a Roman army, and it'll be in some of y'all's lifetime. Most of them have been martyred by this time. John hadn't. But in 70 AD, Titus destroyed the city, and he didn't leave one stone upon another. I think Sister brought out a good point about that. The gold, how it melted down in the stones, and they were tearing them apart to get the gold. Very true. They tore the place apart. Okay? They destroyed the city. And they made it so that nobody could dwell there. They killed hundreds of thousands, innocent women, children, as well as men. They took at least 10,000 Jews into captivity with other slave nations and went down to Rome, and they built the Colosseum, still standing today, part of it, by slave labor. Jews did that. This was prophesied that this would happen, and it did in 70 AD. Now, if the people of the prince that shall come were Romans, that means the prince that shall come has Roman connections. Right? He has to. Now, yeah, I believe that he has Roman ancestry. Okay? I think the Jews were scattered all over the known world. And he has Roman ancestry. He doesn't necessarily have to live in Rome to have Roman ancestry. To live in America, to have Roman ancestry. But he is a Jew. He has to be a Jew. Otherwise, Israel wouldn't accept him. See, he is Jewish in his faith. He's Jewish in his genealogy. I think they'll trace him down to the son of David. He will be one of the sons of David, okay? But some people think that this Roman connection, of course, is the Pope. And he is, I think he is the false prophet of Revelation 13, but I don't necessarily think that this is the connection here. I think it's an actual genealogy. I think it's an actual ancestry that come. He shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. There's your 70-week day. Okay? When the Antichrist rises up and signs this agreement with Israel, the clock starts ticking again. See? Hadn't been ticking since the church has been here. But when the church is gone, then this will take place. I don't know what you think about it, but I kind of see it like this. When Christ catches away his church, there's going to be the awful confusion in this world for a few days that ever was. I mean, people are going to, they're not going to know why. They're going to be looking for answers. People out of government, people out of our churches. Of course, they'll still allow people, they'll still have people coming to church and worshiping and going through it. You know that? But they'll still be church because there's a lot of people that's not saved to go to church. And they'll still keep coming. But there's a bunch of people missing. That there'll be men that were, they knew were Christians are gone. Like I said, in all walks of life, business, government, in church, in all types of work, there are going to be people gone. And there has to be an explanation for it. Okay? Whether this goes for a week or it goes for 2 weeks or even a month, I don't know. But I think there is a little time lapse between the catching away of the church and when the Antichrist rises up. I think there's a time lapse. And everybody's wanting an answer, and he's going to have it. Have you ever heard of what's going on down in Antarctica? Anybody? They've called almost every governor of the world down there. Every the Roman Catholic priest, the Russian Orthodox priest, Buzz Aldrin said it's nothing but evil down there. I mean, you know, I think it scared him. But there's something happening down there. Yet they cannot be revealed yet. They're there. And they've already made contact with men. But they can't be revealed yet. No. You talk about extraterrestrials? Absolutely not. I don't believe there's any extraterrestrials. I don't believe that. I don't think there's anything. Listen, if they were extraterrestrials when they met us, we'd ruin them. we'd mess them up. No. If God created them, that's fine. That's his business and his purpose. But I don't think they're there. But there are demonic sources that are putting themselves forth as extraterrestrials. They've been doing it for years. Over 60% of the world believes in extraterrestrials today. You know that? Yeah. They used to not believe it, but they do now. And all these flying saucers and all this stuff people are saying, it's real. But it's demonic.
Yeah.
It's demonic. Because the devil is going to use that to fool the people that are left when we leave. Now let me show you how. First of all, he can't get out. If he's in Antarctica and he went down there, and there's a story behind that I can tell you, I don't have time. But let's put it this way. His home was Mount Hermon. That's where demons gathered before Jesus came. They even had a god they called Pan. And everybody around there worshiped Pan. It's named after Pan. It's called the Bunyans. But it is biblical, says went up on that mountain and was transfigured. Now, here's the reason he went. Because it had become a haunt of demons. Back in the days before the flood, it was where the fallen angels had gathered and sworn that they would disobey God. And as a result, they were locked up for 70 generations. Okay? And they mixed with the seed of women. Now, demons took Mount Hermon over. It was their haunt. They owned it. But when Jesus walked up there with Peter, James, and John and was transfigured, what happened was when he was glorified, the demons had to go. They had to flee. No place for them anymore. They ran off of that hill, friends. They left. Remember when Jesus came down, there was a boy possessed of a devil. One grabbed him on the way out, and Christ released him. The demons left Mount Hermon because Christ had run them off. You are not allowed here anymore. This is not your place. They went to the Antarctic. And they found a place where nobody would bother them for years. Okay? Now, from there, they've done their dirty work all over the world. And they've been, you know, flying here and there and causing trouble, principalities, powers, and different things in the air. They've been doing that kind of stuff. But their haunt is down there. Well, man has found it. Man has discovered it, and he thinks he's found UFOs. But he's found demons. The issue is they cannot reveal themselves yet. We were here last week. Let's go back to 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter. This is why they can't be revealed. They can't come up yet. But they know the time is short. They watch the signs. Demons watch. They know. They read the Bible. They know more about the Bible than we do. And they know that their time is coming. Now, Paul said in 2 Thessalonians 2, he said, "Let no man," verse 3, "deceive you by any means. That day shall not come, except there come a falling away." Well, that's happened now. We know that. First, and the man of sin be revealed. Son of perdition. That's the Antichrist. Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or above all that is worshipped. So that he is God, setteth in the temple of God, declaring himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? They talked about this. And now you know what withholdeth, what's keeping him from being revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Working right now. It's been working. Ever since we've been, it's been working. Only he who now letteth will let till he be taken out of the way. We told you what that meant. The let there means actually hinder. The mystery of iniquity is working, but there's somebody keeping it from taking over. The Holy Ghost. He is keeping them in check. They can't come out because the Holy Ghost is keeping them in check. They can come out and they can reveal themselves. And they can deceive people, and they can make people think they're UFOs. They can do this, but they cannot take over because the Holy Ghost is here.
He's our protector.
He's our protector, thank God. As long as the church is here, the Holy Ghost is in us. And ain't a thing the devil can do about it. I like that. Then he said, "Shall that wicked be revealed?" Once the Holy Ghost is taken out of the way. And what a takes the Holy Spirit out of the way. Coming of the Lord Jesus, he's taking us out. You know, Romans 8:11 said it, but if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal lives by his Spirit that dwells in you. He's going to put life in you, see? Just like he raised up Christ, he puts life in you and quickens you and raises you up, and you go to meet him in the air. Okay? That's what it says. Now, then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. I want you to listen to this. Even him, the false prophet, the Antichrist, even him who's coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders. I mean, he's going to deceive people. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Why? Because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. In this time of grace, number five, that we're living in right now, people are rejecting the truth. And did you know who's going to be the first ones to be deceived? Those that are rejecting the truth right now. I've had people telling, preacher, well, when I see your God, I'll just get saved. Oh, no, you won't. Mm-mm. You'll be the first one to follow this delusion. Look what it says. With all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved, and for this cause, because they didn't receive the love of the truth, God, not the devil, God shall send them strong delusion. Buddy, when God deceives you, you are deceived. That they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. Now think about that. There's going to come like a blanket over all this world a great deception once we're gone. But between the time that we're gone and this deception comes, I kind of think there might be just a little time slot there. I don't know, maybe you're wrong. Yeah, I could be wrong about this. It may happen immediately. But I think what's going to happen, and these are my personal thoughts, okay? I think since Satan has begun this great deception in the Antarctica, you go and Google this and look at it. You'll see some things if you want to study it. What's going to happen is they're coming up when we're gone. Their 70 generations are over, and they're coming out. And they're going to have a leader over them that will say, I know what happened to those people that you're looking for. They were aliens that were set among you in government, in churches, in business, and they've been there all these years, and they've been spying on you, and they've gone back to their planet. And now we have to rally together as a world because they will be back to invade. You know, there's a lot of truth to that.
Yeah.
We are aliens, aren't we?
We're not in this world.
We're not in this world. And we're leaving here, and we are coming back, and we're going to take over. You know, so there, you know, Satan takes a little bit of truth and greases it with a big lie. And it slips right through. But you see, that this is one way he can do it. There's another way. Yes, he will. He'll take it. going to use this one. This is an old one. Remember what the devil told Eve in the garden? You shall be gods. He'll say these people have attained godhood. They've become gods. And they went up the next rung on the ladder on evolution. They've taken the next step. And if you follow me, I'll show you how to become a God. Now, that'll get bitten if people want. And when you mix that with the great delusion that's coming, people will be in line to get to Mark. They'll be in line to follow this man. They'll be in line to take a man that says, no more war. We'll have peace. We'll settle the Middle East. We'll take care of that problem. People are going to follow this man and think he's the Messiah. Okay? That's what Daniel was telling us. In the first part of the week, when he signs that covenant, that agreement with Israel, the clock starts. Clock is ticking 7 years. 70 if we could date. Remember, it's not to us, it's not to the church, not to the Gentile, it's to Israel. And this 70th week must be fulfilled. And it will be fulfilled when this Antichrist signs this agreement with the nation of Israel. Now, Israel's going to think they got the Messiah. The reason I think so is because he's going to build them a temple. I don't know exactly how that's going to work out. Some people think that the battle between Gog and Magog will destroy the temple, the Dome of the Rock. It might. Some people think, and there's a lot of Orthodox Jews who think that the temple is actually the true temple is actually a little north of where they say it is. So they could build it beside the Dome of the Rock. I don't know. I do know that the Antichrist, he will prove his faithfulness to Israel by building them a temple. Now, how long is that going to take? Well, Dubai. You ever heard of that country, Dubai? They built it out of sand, you know, put the sand out in the sea and make the country. Well, they built one of the tallest buildings in the world in less than a year. Do you think they couldn't build a temple in 6 months or less?
Sure.
And they'll start the offerings back. And Israel will think their Messiah is sitting on the throne. As I said, he has proof that he is of the house and lineage of David, and he has proof that he can do miracles, false prophet with him, Revelation 13, and that's what he's going to do. Okay? So, 70th week of Daniel is made up of what we call the tribulation period. 7 years of tribulation. The first 3.5 years are years where he brings peace. But if you notice in Daniel chapter 9, I think it's verse 27, he says, he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. That's the Orthodox Jews. Not all Jews will accept it. But look, in the midst of the week, that's 3.5 years, right? He shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. Good sign. And for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation or the end of all things. And that determined shall be poured 175 B.C., a man by the name of Antiochus Epiphanes, he is mentioned in Daniel chapter 10 and 11. He was a real historic man. He was from Syria, from the house of Seleucus, who was a general of Alexander the Great. This man went to Jerusalem, to the temple that they had built when they come back from Babylon. And he went in there and he offered a sow on the altar. Well, you know, Jews despise hogs and ham, and this guy did that purposely as an abomination. And it was such an abomination that a group called the Maccabees, you can read about them if you have a Rings do a Catholic Bible. They had the Maccabees in them. And it's a true story. Maccabees, John the Apprentice, and the Hasmoneans went to war with Antiochus and drove him out. And the Maccabees ruled. You remember the story where once the Maccabees took over and they run Antiochus out, they had only enough olive oil to light the lamps for one night. And the miracle of the lamps were that they burned for 8 nights. And the Jews still celebrate that today. Does anybody know what it's called? Hanukkah, exactly. Festival of Lights. Jesus recognized Hanukkah in John chapter 10 when he went into the Feast of Dedication. That's what that was. And it was winter, and he went on Solomon's porch. He was recognizing the Feast Festival of Lights. The Pharisees asked him, how long does thou make us doubt, you know? But tell us if you're the Christ. But he recognized that. That particular holiday is in December. It was winter when Jesus went in. It was December. But Antiochus, once he was driven out, Maccabees, Epiphanes, Hasmoneans, and out of the Hasmoneans came Herod the Great. And we told you about Herod the Great. Remember him? Well, Antiochus becomes a picture type. There's all kinds of pictures that God draws us in the Bible about Christ and about other things. And he draws us a picture of the Antichrist. Just as Antiochus actually did this in 175 B.C., the Antichrist in the 70th week of Daniel, after we're gone 3.5 years, is going to go in to the Holy of Holies, and instead of offering a sow, the false prophet is going to make an image. Look at Revelation 13, you'll see it. He makes an image of the beast, looks just like him, and he causes the image to speak. Remember we talked about Paul the Great? They'll be used in. And all the people will believe this. And he's going to make them worship this image of the Antichrist that was caused to speak in the Holy of Holies. That is the abomination of desolation spoken by Daniel the prophet that Jesus mentioned in Matthew 24. That's it. Okay? So, to try to give you an overview of this, I mean, I wondered about this. I could, but we go verse by verse, we'll get very confused. So, let me just give you an idea of what happened. Okay? There are no signs of the catching away of the bride of Christ. No signs. Paul was looking for him in his time. Peter signs. The signs that the apostles asked for was, what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the age? See? The signs we're seeing today are not signs of the rapture, because it could have already happened. I mean, there's nothing stopping it. The signs that we're seeing are signs of his second coming in Revelation, of his coming in judgment, famines, pestilence, earthquakes. There's 40 earthquakes taking place today. Did you know that? Some of them are 2.2, some of them are 8.0. They're keeping it quiet. They don't want to scare anybody. They don't want to tell anybody. What they're doing is trying to cover up the Bible. You know? There's fearful sights and strange signs in heaven. There are sounds coming from heaven. You know what that is? Romans 8 said that was the earth groaning. It's groaning in travail to be delivered. That's what those sounds are. God's creation is groaning for deliverance. How closely must be to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ? I mean, it's that close. What else? Pestilences, we see that today. Nation rising against nation. Now, we've always had wars, world wars. Do you know what that means? That's civil war. Nation will rise against itself. Kingdom will rise against itself, kingdom. You know, one of the names here? Iraq? Syria? Afghanistan? Turkey? Libya? Yemen? All of these, Egypt even had civil war, but they got straightened out. This is happening. And they're trying to get one going here in America. They're trying to start, the deep state is trying to start a civil war with patriots in this country. We'll talk about that sometime, because we're there, folks. We're there. There's a deep state in this country that would like to destroy America. And we're the reason. America is the only nation standing in the way of globalism,
right,
of a one world government. That's why they want us to destroy. So,
Ronnie, going back to the hand of Christ, and he was accepted in, and Revelation 6, second chapter, or the sixth chapter, second verse, and I saw the community, he said, look in the book.
Yeah.
He said, and I saw the call of the white horse.
Right.
And he had set upon him with a bow.
Yeah.
And was given to him, and went forth to conquer him. Now, that's why that Israel will accept him.
Exactly.
Because he's going to see him, and he's going to give him a sign.
Yes.
And, but you notice that everything wasn't there.
Right.
Yeah. And you can hear that.
So we're he said that Revelation 6:2 is talking about when that seal was opened, there was a white horse. And on that white horse, a man sat with a crown and a bow, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. And that's why the Jews would accept him as their Messiah, because he's a false Messiah. Yeah. I think that's about what you said, wasn't it?
Yeah. He didn't have, he had the bow, but he didn't have no arrows.
Yeah.
We want to take prayer requests real quick.